There are so many pressing food and water issues. I work with a lot of Native American youth, and the issue that's concerning them right now and the thing they're asking me to respond to are access to our waterways. It's a legal issue. It's a food issue. Being Hopi, we completely live off the food we grow.
Climate change is reality, and we need to really adapt to Mother Nature. And the idea is actually to look at the different diversity of crops which we have and do some kind of crop improvement programs which are really based on the realities of the rainfall we are receiving now.
Hopefully, eventually, people will resort back to traditional ecological knowledge of, you know, how did the people before us plant their food? How did they utilize their water? And what type of agricultural practices were set in place in order to have these, have this even made possible?
Ancient peoples, such as Arizona's Hohokam, survived on the lands we are presently on, but we contemporaries are putting much more stress on our food and water delivery systems than ever before. We also know, fortunately, that many of the traditional knowledges and practices developed by those who lived in these lands before us may be adaptable to our current situation.
And we just
move them around.
Yeah, we scrape them up really good, and then when they're done, then we go ahead and boil it.
Traditional knowledge food production systems are more sustainable because they actually value the ecological food production practices and systems. They actually value the importance of soil and water conservation, soil fertility, and they actually are based on producing food which is more nutritious, which has different characteristics in terms of the quality. Whereas when you compare it with the other industrial agriculture systems, the difference is that the food which is supposed to sustain your body is poisoning you, and you end up with a lot of diseases.
You find that farmers are so clever because within the homestead you have your chickens, you have your pumpkins, you have your some trees, some fruits, you name it. So within that homestead, you have huge diversity.
So many things changed. Agriculture, farming, learned a whole lot about what food meant to me. I started to find out a whole lot more about who or where my stand was as an author male. A lot of this stuff it changed me and my view of things.
My favorite example right now of Native American foodways outside of Hopi is San Javier Cooperative Farm. What I really love is there was a time where America was trying to take away land from tribes by dividing it up into small little chunks and saying, okay, you have this land and you have this land and nobody can own it together anymore. And what happened was this tribal community came together and said, well, we're going to be a cooperative. We're not going to give away. We may own this land, but we're going to continue to farm it together. We're going to continue to behave like tribal people. And we're going to work, and all the things from this farmer we deliver to all the people.
You know, really near and dear thing to the farm about this and water is these grow off of the just natural rainfall. You know, it's just out in the desert. But it has a natural sweetness, so you don't have to use, you know, say if you're making cookies, you don't have to use as much sugar in it. So it's a lot of that education in the community.
As we start losing our grandparents, we start to care more about that traditional knowledge that's being lost because maybe we didn't spend enough time with them. Maybe some of us didn't have that access, you know, that others do, because I didn't have my grandparents, you know, they were both, all of them were in Mexico and I was right here. So I didn't have that opportunity to share with them ceremonies of Day of the Dead, any ceremonies, you know, during Christmas or any recipes, you know, I didn't have that opportunity. So I feel like definitely in Tucson, people are definitely taking more into account the traditional knowledge that exists here, whether it be farming, whether it be cooking, or whether it just be like how to present yourself, you know, around nature.
This place is my brother and I's playground and laboratory. We strove to create a landscape that would be irrigated with the rainwater, not city water, and show what's possible in this desert community. This is the rainwater that I collect off the roof into those tanks, and then it comes out this hose. So I'll just fill that up, okay? And then the water will wick through the clay pot into the root zone. It's a primitive subsurface drip irrigation system. I like it below the surface.
So we harvest 100,000 gallons of rain a year that we put into the soil, but only consume 20,000 gallons of city water a year. So we give more than we take.
And the clean water's here. And then I fill up my glass with that rainwater. And how does it taste? Delicious.
I think what's key is exposing people to what is the reality of this place. Letting them have that experience through as many senses as possible. Taste, touch, hearing, you know, sight, feeling in the gut, all that.
A little bit.
Okay, yeah, only losing a little.
With the kids and the adults, I want them to see what's possible. And so what I find again and again is giving these tours for any age person, they'll light up. They get excited about stuff like, wow, that's so simple. That makes so much sense. And so I want to plant that seed of what's possible just working with what's freely at hand.
My name is Claudio Rodriguez, and I'm part of the Arid organization. Our organization actually started in 1492. So for all y'all that don't know what Tierra en Libertad means, it means land and freedom, because that's what we want. We want land and freedom. And we actually came about responding to the urgency that we saw in our community. And we responded with community-based solutions that address the vast economic, health, and political injustices. We just strive to create a better narrative for our community. We gather community members, you know, different stakeholders to come out to our events. This is our backyard garden. It's just a little house in the hood that we created into a demonstration site. Yeah, you can see some faces in there who've come out to the events. You might see some of them around the room. And this is what we do. We just get people out there, get people connected back to the outdoors. Because our communities were always impacted by trauma, historical trauma, by years of oppression. So how do we combat that? Well, we spray walls. You know, these kids right here, they were arrested for tagging. So we bring them back out. I'm like, all right, you're gonna tag. Put ants on the wall. Because just like ants, we're gonna devour the elephant.
This generation is so disconnected that it doesn't know what a walnut looks when it is in its shell. It doesn't know what a pineapple looks like, how to cut fruit. It doesn't know that the leaves of an orange tree are highly medicinal, and so are its flowers. People don't know that if they have any kind of fruit tree in their environment, that they can actually eat more than the fruit from the tree, that the tree bark may be medicinal. All of these things in nature exist and are medicine for human beings. All these are relatives that are planted here, are herb relatives. Some of them are herbs that you find in your kitchen, and others are desert plants that are indigenous, the original plant peoples. And then we have some sacred medicines. Traditional knowledge comes from how we were created as human beings. As we sought to survive, we evolved because of our relationship with the plant world, with the elements of life, the water, the wind, the earth, and the fire. It's something that's been lost as we live under the illusion that we are not part of the natural world at every moment.
Culture of the indigenous people, their food, how do they manage to harvest water and survive on minimal things that they pick up from the desert. We need to learn a lot of things from them. They don't waste, we do.
Allora, è molto più lunga. È molto più lunga perché i lacci, no? Devono stare a distanza uno dall'altro. Ok?
È molto importante parlare della biodiversità e della sostenibilità dal punto di vista ambientale, dal punto di vista economico, dal punto di vista sociale. Dal punto di vista sociale occorre recuperare le tradizioni, perché all'interno delle tradizioni c'è già il principio della sostenibilità in molti casi, cosa che noi abbiamo perso.
My future envisions that people will utilize rainwater harvesting or some sort of sustainable practice that would allow them to collect water and use it on their property as opposed to needing water from municipal sources in order to make those practices happen.
I come from a long line of farmers and scientists, and I respect the land. And I think that we need to learn how to take care of Mother Earth before it's too late.